what we have started last week. I hope you are dealing with reading assignments. You know, the most important thing in this case is reading assignments. Really. I hope you are reading that. If you remember last week, not just last week, maybe on last Thursday, lecture. So the third chapter was about the foreign policy process, the strategies and traditions we tried to touch last time. How is really the foreign policy being crafted and designed? What are the different strategies that are dealt with? For example, the point of departure when you craft, or the initial assumptions, or the determinants of designing foreign policy. And then what are the traditions means the traditional component will be accomplished by you, because we will see the US tradition, the Ethiopian tradition, the Kenyan and the Sudanese and even the Egyptian tradition. So when say tradition is normally the way how that policy is being crafted and ratified and finally implemented and evaluated. So the phases of foreign policy making. Anyway, there is no hard and fast rule which says there are this number of stages in formulating foreign policy. Rather, we will see some of the important issues like the issue of reciprocity and the issue of dominance and the issue of self-interest. These are the key issues that we need to address when we are talking with the phases of formulating foreign policy. Foreign policy strategic tools and techniques, for example, in relation to foreign policy and in relation to power that the nations have. We can say, let's say, country X has have 10% of the global power. We may say that, okay? How do we really measure the power of states? With what strategies and tools, actually? With what tools? That's what they call it, the foreign policy tools, actually, strategy. And finally, the foreign policy styles and traditions will be accomplished by next week. This is one of the biggest chapter in the whole course. The remaining two chapters, for example, they are a lecture of one session or two sessions, so the remaining three chapters will be just three sessions. So we will deal with this one. A maximum of four sessions will be left if we are going stronger. So I will really stress for those of you, probably if you are not around last week, what are really the expectations from foreign policy making? We have listed last time. That expectation can be seen sectorally, they can be seen spatially, they can be seen temporally. Focus in terms of time, focus in terms of space or territory, and focus in terms of temporal, or what I mean, in terms of interest that the nations can have. So I hope we have already done with this one. And then the three steps, we tried to mention this, and we were on the first stage, on the formulation stage, and the role of think tank groups and relevant baseline or policy development institutions, or those institutions that can really generate baseline data, they can really play a great role. A very good example is the US foreign policy think tank groups. If you read each group or each institution, I promised you, or I really told you, that you will get a lot of issues that can be adapted to our country or our area of focus or context. So anyway, we try to see that one, even there are some important issues, and then every foreign policy or every country has its own foreign policy focus areas, the Central America, the Eastern Europe, the Western America, and the Far East, in the Middle East, and the Sub-Saharan countries, they have their own perpetual level of pursuit or perpetual interest. So I think you can really get on this one, and you can enrich with some sort of reading. So there is a big question in the formulation of international policy. One of these big questions is how interests and issues for everyone can be solved in internationally. You know, when we are really talking about foreign policy, it's part of the issues that we can adjust and do in relation to international relations. And we said it, foreign policy is one of the proper subsets for international relations. So generally, we are drafting foreign policy just to really fulfill our interests, and then, I mean, to maximize our interests and even to demise or minimize the challenges that we are really facing with an international relations. So when we are talking about foreign policy, please remember, we are really focusing in relation to a growing interest within international relations. So the issue in international relations is that countries are really growing more international, more global, more transnational, generally. That is the challenge, by the way. However, there are a number of countries and there are a number of interests across countries or even within countries, within regions or continents, number of interests. But the question is, how this can be really solved or how this can be really compromised? So because of the intensification of various interests, conflicts may arise. This is one of the biggest questions that the foreign policy making process should resolve within the whole framework of international relations. So this question can be answered through understanding the concept of dominance, reciprocity, and identity. We can answer this question in three ways. One, through the creation and narration of dominance. Second, through the appreciation of reciprocity. And third, through the analysis of identity. So let's see. Dominance, reciprocity, and identity. What's the dominance? How dominance can really solve the divergence of interests in the global or in the international relation? Normally, dominance means there may be that interest can be really compromised or entertained, or even if there is a resource that becomes a cause for conflict, how can we really share that conflict? That's one important issue. That resource can be really solved through dominance, through reciprocity, or through identity. Now assume there is one global challenge, the global warming. It's really one collective problem. That collective problem can be solved through, let's say, dominance. Dominance means through the creation of powerful institutions so that other less powered institutions or countries should follow the footsteps of the dominant powerful actor. Or probably that dominance can be, maybe the most powerful country may take the lead on that issue and other less powerful countries or even alliances may follow it. So we can maximize or we can really resolve conflicts or collective good problem that's happening in the world through the understanding of dominance. For example, we say, what is the position of America on this regard? What is the position of Russia? What is the position? For example, if Ethiopia wants to really build a second dam, probably around, let's say, western part of Shawa or somewhere next to Renaissance Dam, the first question that the country may say, okay, what is the response of neighboring countries? Come out of it. The first thing is, the superpowers, who are always assuming who are really the dominant. So remember, our chapter is foreign policy making. So we have to think and we have to consider that dominance. If our foreign policy making process and if our foreign policy, if the substantial part or the document of our foreign policy really is against the interest of those dominating powers, definitely we are creating an enemy upon us. Even before the ratification of the document, we will get serious opposition. Anyway, solving the collective good problem by establishing a power hierarchy with those at the top control those below. So this is really happening. This is really common. So the good thing to have this dominance or the good thing to have a dominant or a strong state or power in the global or in the international relation is it's good because it really ensures order. It can also ensure stability and it also tells us the future predictability nature of that issue. I mean, predictability. So it will help us order to really establish order, establish stability, and to have the prediction capacity. The bad thing is oppression and resentment. So, we are always really being led by those powerful pastors, powerful countries. This, we may really develop a sense of oppression, and resentment means enmity. So, I know we are countries, but those who decide are those the dominating nations, so those who are powerful nations. I mean, so the collective good, for example, the collective good could be clean air. The collective good could be global peace. The collective good could be removing COVID-19, for example. So Ethiopia may follow, for example, if those dominant nations really follow something, then it's really follow. Of course, this COVID is sporadic and it's a temporary problem. That may not be really a very good example for the crafting of foreign policy. Foreign policy, if you remember in chapter 1, we said, let's have some nature of stability, and that we consider from at least mid-term and long-term perspective. So remember our big question back, how the interests and issues for everyone can be solved? We said it, the first one is through dominance. Simply we'll follow those powerful nations, so that if we are really following powerful nations, our foreign policy will be crafted just from this perspective. And we have to make sure that in our foreign policy, we are not really against those dominating powers. Reciprocity. The other thing is through reciprocity. Reciprocity can solve the collective good problem by rewarding behavior that positively contributes to the group or the world or the nations, and opposite, and punishing behavior that pursues self-interest at the expense of the group. So, reciprocity is, it's not the issue of dominance, but if we are doing this, we'll get this plus. If we are not doing this, we'll get this minus. So we have to really indicate that in our foreign policy document. So the good thing to assume this reciprocity is it incentivizes for mutual cooperation. If there is mutual cooperation, countries, they may incentivize each other. The bad thing is downward spirals. Downward spiral means punishment. For example, you can consider North Korea. North Korea is a very good example for a downward component of reciprocity. When one sanction is done, another sanction come. When that sanction is done, another sanction come. Because reciprocity means that country is not really following the one that can be considered as a rewarding behavior. But remember, please remember, who will decide this behavior is rewarding and that behavior is not rewarding? Definitely the dominance. So indirectly, dominance is a key issue in the framework of devising international foreign policy, or just devising foreign policy. The other issue that we can really entertain, even conflicting interests, is just like creating a mentality which is called the win-win, the identity issue. Identity solves the collective good problem by sacrificing one's own interest to help others. To help others. Yeah, let's leave them. Let's put them, okay, let's put it, if that's not really a serious issue, that's the question of identity. But in this identity, normally, it's just to create a better public image or international image among the dominance. And this is mostly accomplished by still the powerful ones, but they say that it's really for good benefit. So the good thing in this case is sacrification for the groups, maybe groups of countries or alliance. The bad thing is even demonizing an out group. So those who are out of this collective good, so if they are not, there's that sacrification will not be done. A very good example is opening trade, like trade routes, like encouraging trade routes, minimizing trade barriers, supporting through military equipments and technology for those who are really appreciating those ones. So anyway, we're really answering this one. We're really answering this big question. That big question is how interests can be compromised or entertained in the framework of drafting foreign policy. And we're really saying dominance, reciprocity, and identity. Please, if you have really time, read about this dominance, reciprocity, and identity in foreign policy making. I hope you will get a lot of cases and lots, right? So I will ask you this one. On which factor or on which approach or on which style do you think is Ethiopia's policy, the current policy, for example, in Mandemar, I hope it's already proposed that. In which one? Of course, in its foreign policy, Ethiopia says that, especially in terms of neighboring, Karas le gorabet abzuto mechana kilal, or like that. Okay. Anyway, the advice from experts in international foreign policy making is the first thing is really, really to begin with this one. And then the next one is this one. So for developing countries, this is the most important thing, because they are really growing and developing. They need something, so they have to give something. So this is one. But they should really consider that their foreign policy is not in contradiction with all this one. And then they have to also maximize how the identity section can really benefit their foreign policy. Anyway, who are the actors? Who are the actors in foreign policy making? The most important actors in international relations, I mean foreign policy, are world governments. The governments, is that right? Governments with sovereignty and legitimacy. These are the key parameters or the key variables to say really states. So there are states. Please remember, there are four confusing terms that you need to really understand. And if it's not clear even in my class, you have to really browse and really have to make sure that you have clarity between these four terms. One is state, the second one is nation, the third one is country, and the fourth one is nation state. So the difference, the similarities and difference between this is very, very important. So let's see what is really a state. States are really excellent actors, the best actors in devising foreign policy. So a state government exercises sovereignty over its territory. Sovereignty means they can decide their own destiny. The destiny of the state can be decided, and that will not be touched by any other external party or body. So the state has also ability to make or enforce laws, the capacity, the institutional capacity to enforce laws, and then even, for instance, even to collect taxes and like that. And then
sorry, doctor.
Yes.
Would you mind to admit in Binian?
Bini is still is not coming. I cannot see him even on the.
He's waiting for your permission.
Definitely, I have to permit him.
Has to come. Very nice.
Yeah, Binyam is already in the class. I can see him in the. Yeah, he's in the class.
Yeah, just is connected.
Can you see? It's on the screen.
Yeah, Binyam is somewhere. Yeah, I can see him, but I think he is not.
Maybe in a good. May not be in a good connection. I don't know. Okay, I may repeat. Maybe explain for him, or I don't know, what can I do? I can't see him, and even this is my cell phone. He did not see me. I think he has internet already. Yeah,
but still he can't.
Binyam, can you hear me? Are you there, Binyam? Yeah, I see him, but even his phone.
Yeah, I think he is not hearing.
Yeah. Okay. Let's
see. Doctor, I only samanya.
Okay. Istamal, welcome.
Okay.
Very good.
RPG selamat, doctor. Mabratum.
I understand you guys. I no problem. This is just simple, you know. If you have some challenge while you are reading, please ask me. I can even repeat it, okay? So, welcome. So yeah, thank you very much. States are really the key actors in foreign policy making, yeah? States mean world governments, but sometimes these governments, you need to really differentiate the confusion between these four elements, the state, nation, country, and nation state. So, those who are really dealing with foreign policy are states, okay? States. So a state is a government exercising sovereignty over its territory. States have the ability to make or enforce laws, they say to collect taxes and etc. And a state to be a state is, it should be recognized as legitimate by other states. Not only other states, even the citizens say that this is our state. We are least, so we have this law, and therefore they have to really ensure their election or their preference by being a member of, or by having a set of government with, even with a leader. So this is what you call it, states. So states are the most powerful actors in international relations, and it is those who are really dealing with foreign policy. However, these states, they really deal with their foreign policy in relation to some other important variables, for example, nations or a nation. So state definition versus, I mean, nation, already we have defined what state is, but when you say nation, means groups of people, it refers to groups of people who share a national identity and culture. They say that we have our culture is the same, but they may not necessarily be. So that's what we call it is a national. Our national identity is like this. Our national identity is like that. So they have the capacity or the term to really do like that. Okay, I think somebody is really pardon, I have to answer this. Very sorry, rather than interrupting you, I have to answer that also. When you say a nation, it's groups of people who share like national identity and culture, mainly just culture. They may not be as such like sovereign, and they may not really, let's say, that may not be legitimate, no? So when you say a country, it means really a territory. But when you say a nation state, it means states whose population has a sense of national identity. That's somehow closer to state, but a nation state, if some part of nations, they become more stronger, and they may approach it to a nation state. And then when it becomes more stronger, then it will be like a nation state. So please try to really do that. But anyway, I really focus on the topic that who are the actors. So states are really good actors, but in foreign policy making, but it doesn't mean that the interests of all this will not be fulfilled in foreign policy. But all this will be entertained in domestic policy issues, and it's based on domestic policy issue or a domestic policy documents, they can be good inputs for the crafting international or foreign policy. So we will see later that what are the determinants of foreign policy, that the internal determinants and the external determinants. So with whatever type of formation and actors, some of the nations are powerful, some of the nations are highly powerful, some of the nations are really almost with zero power or like that. So let's see some of the findings. Some of the findings that the world really somehow like 5 or 6 years ago, I really got the from a publication six years ago. So if you see the state and the power of the percentage of power in the global phenomenon, it means percentage means out of 100. For example, USA is around 15%, China is around 12 or 13%, Russia is this much percent, Japan is this much percent, Germany with this, United Kingdom, and even France. But these days, like countries like India, like Brazil, like Nigeria, like Ethiopia, can we say? Yeah, they're really merging to be somehow powerful states. So now I will ask you one methodological question. How can we measure the power of states? What data are going to be major powers that alone does he make a motor? Have you read? So I am really pushing you to be on this one. But there are some important variables. One of these variables, let's say, the way how these variables can be treated is classifying them into direct variables and proxy variables, or they can be classified into internal and external variables. Please read about the power of states, the power of states, or algorithms in relation to power of states. So that's really made on some important parameters. We will see, by the way, I'll show you and we will discuss all that. The other thing is not only just at individual levels, countries, they can have also north-south separation is the most common way of separating countries. The north will be considered the most advantageous and somehow much powerful compared to the south, but will it be continued in the coming century? Or will it be continued just in these days is still were in question. So this is really the north-south separation. You can see the north-south separation really include this one, the border between USA and Mexico, if it's not fenced by Donald Trump, you can imagine. And then you can see this. Oh, anyway, these are some of the indicators to really say north-south. And even within the north, we can have north-north and we can have south-south collaborations. And like all these collaborations are due to the pressures that are coming from the other side. So I hope you can really do that. So you can really say that, or you can search the global power sect. If you really read on these issues, you'll get a lot of. So now I have asked you two questions. The first question is measurement of state power. How do we really measure? What are the research methodologies? If somebody, of course, you are not international relations students, so you don't want to make a thesis on this one. So at least you need to understand on this. Previously, I showed you some of the important questions. The first question was how interests and positions within the global relations can be really intercepted or really compromised. I said it through the concept of dominance, reciprocity, and identity we are learning. And then what are all these? And then who are the actors? One is nation-related actors, but these nation-related actors have their own power. Different countries have really relatively. So can you see that the power of this power really continuing like this, or do you think that there is some power displacement, global power displacement? Some of those bigger powers are losing their already upholding the power, and then some of the countries. And what do you feel, for example, with the current pandemic?
Doctor,
for example,
does economic dominance play a bigger role in this situation?
Yes, economic dominance, it's one of the biggest issues, by the way. Even population, we will see these variables, definitely. Even military, there are a lot of variables, but economic dominance is the most important one, by the way. It is a super, it's one of the highest dominating variables within the global power sharing. That's really very, very important. We cannot deny it, by the way. Even more than military, by the way. Military is nothing. It's just if you have huge military without just sustainable or strong economic base, the military itself can make a coup d'etat on your own government and then they will take power. So that's
what so other, right. What other major indicator can play a bigger role to calculate such a percentage value? Because what I can see is Russia and Japan has emerged with a very tight proximity in number.
Exactly. Even India these days, if you consider, for example, India, it's really becoming influential because of its export of knowledge. If you see many of the most intelligent researchers and scientists, if you go to US or even Germany, Europe, Indians are really playing a great role. You are right. We will see just after some minutes, we will see that what are really the variables that should be considered even to deal with or to measure global power. So we will see that one, but don't forget that economy is the first one. The other thing is resource base, military, we will see them. So I have one question below that. How do you think is this power measured? That's also already we are really discussing it. The other thing is non-state actors. Our question is, who are the actors in making global order? The state actors, you said the non-state actors. I said last time, even international organizations like the OPEC, can be G8 or whatever, like NATO or UN, ECOWAS, or like IGAD, I don't know, you can say like Amnesty International, all these international organizations, they can't really play a role. Intergovernmental organizations are this, but non-governmental organizations like Amnesty, it can be even NGOs, sometimes they can be large privates, maybe established by, very good example is by Bill Gates and the foundation of Bill Gates, and a number of initiatives by Mr. Bill Gates, like the Amnesty International, the Red Cross, like which was established by Mr. Henry Duna, and then it's really they have their own really influence on the establishment of global order of governance. And then we need to also consider, remember our chapter is foreign policy formulation, and these are some of the most important variables that we have to consider. Even multinational corporations, companies that span even borders. You can mention a lot, like the British Petrol, the Toyota, the Walmart, the Shell, the Tesco, you know, the NATO, the Aldi, all these really companies, they can have their own relationship. Anyway, there are some continuum on this one, even the domestic businesses. Next to domestic businesses, the role that transnational businesses, next to transnational businesses and international businesses, next to that, the multinational businesses, and finally, with the global businesses. So this continuum can have its own really role in the formulation of, and then potentially to be considered in the formulation of foreign policy. Of course, individuals, scientists, and then think tank leaders. So this could be even leaders of countries and leaders of this such organizations can really play a great role. So levels of analysis, remember, we are on foreign policy, and we already said it in the introduction part, since the course is foreign policy formulation and analysis, we touch something, but here, the most important thing when we are really formulating a foreign policy, it's not free from analysis. The best foreign policy formulation really is followed by the best level of analysis. That analysis is mainly by answering why question. Why do we have this one as our pillar in our international or in our foreign policy making? Why do we involve these groups? Why not this? So this is a very important thing. Of course, there is no correct answer related to level of analysis, but still that why question is a very, very important one. For instance, from history, that you can see why war in Iraq? Why war in Iraq? If you want to make individual level analysis, we can have domestic level of analysis, we can have interstate level and even global level of analysis. For example, if we see our analysis from global perspective, that means fear of terrorism, which is a global threat. So we can say that the war in Iraq is just from that. Even from individual, for example, George Bush's desire to oust a world leader, you know, to be just the issue of dominance. Even from domestic perspective, like a kind of neoconservative rise in the US, mostly, most of the literature, they say the war in Iraq, when they analyze it from domestic perspective, they really conclude, most of them conclude that that is an indicator for the rise of neoconservative attitude within the US, particularly among the Republicans. So that's domestic level. So what type of foreign policy can we really pursue if we are now domestically with the rise of neoconservatism is one thing. Even interstate analysis, like the US could attack Iraq because it was not supported by another state. If we attack Iraq, no one will really quarrel with us. So that can be seen in this way, okay? So anyway, there are different levels of analysis. So then our policy formulation even can be good if we start from this one so that we can have some correct policy, I mean, correct, quote unquote, that is really correct. So what are really the different foreign policy making approach? Now the why question, we have answered it. The biggest question is the how question. Okay, the why is this one, but how question is still the thing that we need to deal with. The how question is always and mostly, almost always, it will answer with some frameworks, we call them approaches, and how still with models. The how question, foreign making, for example, one is, especially these days, one of the most commonly used approach is the comparative foreign policy approach. This is a comparative approach. It means comparing states to see if they have similar or different types of foreign policies. For example, our foreign policy is this one. Then we have to compare it. Can we really, can this policy go with the policy of the country with which we are really dealing with much trade exchange or much economic relation? Or our foreign policy may be like this, but is it foreign policy? Is this document can go in line with the interests of Britain because it may have some support or some collaboration as well? So this type of mentality is what you call it, the comparative foreign policy. And the comparative foreign policy approach, again, it can be approached in three major ways. The first way is, how does size, wealth, and demography, based on the size, the wealth, the size of the nation, the wealth of the nation, and the nature of demographies that nation can have, determine the type of foreign policy decisions? Maybe this is one. We may compare, for example, Ethiopia versus Djibouti, or Ethiopia versus size, if really depending on size. So we may have a comparative perspective based on size, based on wealth, and based on demography. I'm really surprised with some of the European countries. For example, if you go Denmark, that's a small country in terms of size. And I usually see that mostly the Danish government is approaching those smaller countries in Western Africa, like Togo, like Benin, like Lesotho, or like, I'm really surprised with this one. So now, thanks for international relations course that I have really learned some years ago. That's really common. Normally, it's bigger countries really, they really approach big. So that's one important. Size really matters. So foreign policy decisions may consider these things. The other thing is, how do population, answering this question, like how do population, natural resource, and technology are really interacted? Or the interaction or the nexus between all this. The population is, let's say, well educated, and we may have a very nice technology, but we may have the technology, whereas the population is somehow very low. So naturally, so based on this, again, we can have foreign policy decisions. How does a state's political culture, the country's political culture and the country's or the state's history, it can be a prerequisite to have the type of, a certain type of foreign policy decision. Anyway, one of the approach is to follow a comparative approach. Following a comparative approach and crafting a foreign policy again can be seen from these three sub-approaches, or we can see them separately or we can see them together. Therefore, foreign policy outcomes result from multiple layer of forces, or multiple forces that can be analyzed at various levels of analysis. So, various levels of analysis should be made, because really remember that's really one of the key determinant factors to decide on the fate of our future generation. So one is that. So one of the approaches is the most common approach in formulating foreign policy is following the comparative for policy formation approach, which has these three sub-variables of approach. Remember our topic is how, the how question. The why question, we already answered this, the why question. This why question will be answered by analysis, but the how question is the issue related to approach and model. But coming to models, there are a number of models, and one of the most common, model, I tried to touch it in chapter one, the most common model that can be employed in using foreign policy making is rational model. The rational model, as I said it last time, maybe in the first lecture, if you are around, decision-makers set goals. Decision-makers means foreign policy advisors and policy workers. They set goals. They evaluate the relative importance. The relative importance of the goal will be evaluated based on various criteria, and they compute the costs and benefits of pursuing these options and the possible course of action by following them, and then choose the one with the highest benefits and the lowest cost. This is really the rational model. But as I said it last time, there is no absolute rationality. So mostly our models and our variables will be constrained by a number of factors. Therefore, our rational model will be constrained by these factors. So we may modify it into a modified rational model, which is called bounded rationality model. The other important model is what we call it the organizational process model, because countries may not be really ready. Some urgent actions may force countries to really follow. So that some countries are really ready. They make a document that's ready based on some policy decision, and then they can respond to that challenge or opportunity based on already available standards and somehow well-acknowledged operating procedures. Like even the government bargaining, what you call the bureaucratic model. Foreign policy can also be formed based on this model, where the foreign policy is an important point of agreement and argument between important or various government agencies. So different government agencies, they come together and they may see that policy from their own affair or from their own mission and vision. Whereas this one is somehow an already standardized modus operandi or mode of operation is already available, and they can be, because some countries may be forced to respond for some issues like urgently. Assume that the case of COVID, what kind of foreign policy can we really develop, or can we really modify our foreign policy just because of a certain pandemic? We may not have that. So, but if we have some urgent issues, for responding to some urgent issues, some standardized modus operandi or modes of operation will be there. This is what we call it, the organizational process model. The other way of crafting foreign policy is just based on individual interests. We cannot miss, you know. Some of the already available standards may not work, but the leader is responsible. He may not say that, oh, there is no policy that says like this, it's something new is happening in my country. So you may not ask people, please, let's draft policy for that. There will not be time, so he has to immediately react. So still there are some cases where individuals can really play a great role. So study of individual decision-making revolves around the question of rationality. For example, to what extent are national leaders able to make rational decisions? How many of the national leaders like Trump, they are really even estimating the number of days that they say it's not more than 100, but today it's really become 100. I don't know what you say tomorrow, really. So anyway, the level of correctness, how much is rationality of interest? Really, that's the funniest thing, because for everything, we may not have everything ready in written form on the table. So still, individuals can have their own say. Individual decisions reflect the values and beliefs of the decision maker as well as their personality. Definitely, the personality of the person, knowingly or unknowingly, even consciously or unconsciously, it may affect the country positively or negatively. So this is unavoidable, but it has given a lesser weight. As much as possible, most of the policies should be done not only on this individual basis, but also with the previous models and approach. But there are some urgent cases where even individuals can have a superpower over the matters that they are facing. Even individual decision making, normally when they are evaluated, much literature really indicates that individual decision making diverges from rationality. Mostly it's not, individuals are not by the way rational, according to some of the, most of the, on economic aggregate consumption or let's say like individuals are rational, but on foreign affairs, because the issue of foreign or whatever is the issue of pluralistic. So foreign policy is mostly victim of individual decision makers because individuals normally they diverge from rationality model at least in three systematic ways, in three ways. The first reason that individuals are really far from rational decision-making model are decision makers suffer from misconceptions and even selective perceptions, those psychological disorders. By the way, those the issue of perception. Perception might not be reality. Perception is nothing but it is sensation plus interpretation. You may sense something. Assume our customer tilik yona betam bam tilik fundata bifatar. All of you, you will not have the same perception. Some of you say that maybe a terrorist bomb has do that. Some of you say because maybe volcano. Some of you say that somebody has fallen from. So perception is nothing but the sensation, sensing something using our sense organs, plus the interpretation that we are providing for that. Definitely this may or may not be rational. Rationality is just based on evidence. So that's really, so selective perception means that. A very good example is the perception of George W. Bush on Saddam. That's really on Iraq, you know? They have a number of misconceptions. Iraq is like that, Iraq have that biological part like that, knowing your name, they have that. Selective perception means we will be really attracted only for some of the words or some of the terms that we are listening. We may not have equal attention for most of the things that we are listening, for most of the things that are. This is what we call a selective perception. That can be even a cause for distortion of reality. It means being far from rational model. The other reason that individuals may far from rational decision model is they have affective bias. It means not being able to make the most rational decision because of the emotions or the feelings that people have at a certain time. For example, if I ask you, on which hours of the day, if you are a manager, on which hours of the day that you have a better mood calendar? I think you may have daily mood calendar, I hope is. I encourage you, for example, in your office, you can have which time you have very good mood, and then don't forget that, oh, now I am very energetic, I am doing it. So please stick it on a certain paper or like that. And then do it at least for the coming maybe 2 or 3 months. Definitely you will get a kind of correlation. So that's what we call it, feeling. And if I ask you, on which time do you want, for example, make a deal? If you want to deal things, on which hour, morning, lunch time, after lunch, or immediately before lunch, or like that. Anyway, mood, that's really not only the timing, but also other variables that happen around you. And the other reason is cognitive bias. It means individuals may not be able to make the most rational decision because their brain cannot comprehend all possible options at a time. That's what we call it cognitive bias, or ability can also be like that. So countries are encouraged not to depend on individuals as much as possible. Even if they really depend on individuals, they have to make aware that individual decision makers are much far from rational model. So anyway, the other approach to see the stakes in foreign policy decision making, one, the first stage already, you know, there are other approaches also. We have to see at least the second approach, the assessment stage, the goal setting stage, the determination of policy option stage, the formal decision-making stage, and the implementation of chosen policy options. So some really well-known writers and well-acknowledged materials, they really say that there are five stages, others say there are four stages. Anyway, the most important stage is assessment and goal setting stage. If we have a wrong assessment, if we have a wrong mindset, I think our goal will not be that much set in a fruitful way. Anyway, when you say the assessment stage, according to assessment stage, says foreign policy is made and implemented within an international and domestic political context. Okay, not only the international, but also looking at the domestic political context, which must be understood by a state in order to determine the best foreign policy option. For example, a state may need to really respond to some international or national really crisis. So the goal setting stage, according to the goal setting stage, it means a state may have multiple foreign policy goals. So a state must determine which goal is affected by the international and the domestic political environment at any time. So in addition to that, foreign policy goals sometimes even may conflict. So we may need to really commensurate or we may need to synchronize all this. Therefore, really, they require they require what you call it is prioritization. Okay, we need to really prioritize this conflicting interest or conflicting goals. The issue of priority is very, very important. And the third stage definitely will be the
በትምህርት ከፍ ብሎ መብረር ይቻላል ናሽናል አቪዬሽን ኮሌጅ የናሽናል ኤርዌይስ እህት ኩባንያ ከከፍተኛ ትምህርት አግባብነትና ጥራት ኤጀንሲ ሙሉ ቅናን ባገኘንባቸው በማስተርስ ዲግሪ MBA በስትራቴጂክ ማኔጅመንት MBA በባንኪንግ እና ፋይናንስ MBA በቢዝነስ ሊደርሺፕ MBA በሪስክ እና ኢንሹራንስ MSc በኢንተርናሽናል ትሬድ እና ኢኮኖሚክስ ዘርፎች በእውቀት ለመቅረጽ የበቁ ፕሮፌሰሮቻችን አረንጓዴ መብራታቸውን አብርተዋል። በነገራችን ላይ በኬንያ ሀገር ከሚገኙ ስመጥር ዩኒቨርሲቲዎች በሚመጡ ፕሮፌሰሮች የትኩረት መስክ ትምህርቶቹ መሰጠታቸው ልዩ ያደርገናል። በምርጥ የትምህርት ስርዓት የተገነባው ናሽናል አቪዬሽን ኮሌጅ በመጀመሪያ ዲግሪ በአቪዬሽን ማኔጅመንት፣ በሆቴል ማኔጅመንት፣ በአካውንቲንግ እና ፋይናንስ፣ በማርኬቲንግ ማኔጅመንት አስተማማኝ ትምህርት ይገብዩና ራስዎንና ሀገሮን ይለውጡ። አድራሻ 22 አደባባይ ወደ ሾላ በሚወስደው መንገድ ላይ። ናሽናል አቪዬሽን ኮሌጅ የናሽናል ኤርዌይስ እህት ኩባንያ ህልሞን እውን ያደርጋል።
The third stage is determination of policy options. I hope you can read it. So states must determine what policy options are available, what options are really available to meet the goal or goals that are already set within the well-acknowledged political environment. Actually, this may really involve an assessment of the state's capacity to implement the policy options. Capacity should be also be considered. It's not only on the goodness of the policy, but the capacity and assessment of consequences of each policy option. What will be the consequence of this? We are adhered to that. And the fourth stage is formal decision making, where we can have this formal decision making. Maybe that can be done at various levels. So you can see it from, let's say, from the head of state perspective, the role of the head of state and who will do that, and the role of the head of the state and head of the government. Normally the head of state is the president, whereas head of the government is a major country, is a prime minister, and trying to share that even the cabinet and the ministers, and then cascading that one to all at all these levels. But what's wrong mainly for most of the countries is they give the assignment only for the foreign minister. And they say that, oh, why the foreign minister is not doing this? No, it's not like that. If you go to the global diplomatic environment is now really changing mostly towards like economic lobbying, economic diplomacy, rather than pure political diplomacy, because the economy is really a determinant factor. So the working much on economic diplomacy is really very, very important. So proper cascading of, properly counting and cascading the share of the different ministries and heads of different governments or states should be really reflected. And the fifth one is, of course, implementation. And you can have that on. And implementing of the fusion option is the one that we need to really recognize. So what are really the different objectives in foreign policy making? We can have short-range objectives. I think the short-range objectives are like mostly their territorial integrities and then the political independence and how we are really doing with this physical and the border issues. And there is no actually no luxury related to the short-term objectives. So there is no question with the territorial integrity. When it comes to mid-range objectives, mid-range objectives in foreign policy, they are composed of economic uplift of the people, like improving the living standard of the people. Which type of foreign policy intervention can really contribute to this one? And then we have to mainly look our FDI policy, our FDI issues, even raising the living standards of people, enhancing the prestige and the status of the nation, and generally an expansion both in terms of territorial as well as ideological expansion can be really considered as the mid-range objectives. The long-range objectives are actually really long, by the way. Maybe they consider like 50 years, minimum of 30 or 25 years, even 100 years, our long-term objectives. A state says, when a state really pursue long-range objectives, and then it needs to really gain almost at the expense of other states, by the way. Most of the long-range objectives are really acquired at the expense of other states, and it may not be such really a good thing for most of those who are pursuing it. Further, they have no time to review restrictions. How long is long? As the time is usually employed in the pursuit of core and range objectives. So,
Doctor,
as expensive. Yes, yes.
In a country like Ethiopia, those governments are repeatedly changing from time to time. How could they set up a long range objective in order to have a stagnant foreign policy?
Yeah, that's a very good question. Anyone who can answer from the class, any reflection? Yeah. That's the case of Ethiopia is really sometimes, by the way, that's one of the tough questions, by the way. In the absence of even consensus at domestic policy, it's very, very difficult even to have to think of all these long-range objectives. But definitely, there are some issues that whatever types of actors may really accept it. For example, the let's say the territorial integrity that can be really can we really consider us anyway? Even in my lecture, even in most of the countries, it says like a vague, like nothing can be ascertained regarding the outcome of the pursuit of such unpredictable objectives. So, the very good example is the issue of Russian and communist leaders. And then, mostly, these long range objectives, if these long range objectives are devised with less or lesser degree of national consensus, they may fire back, okay? They may fire back. That's what's happening for Mussolini. That's what happening, or the German leaders. That's what happening on the Russia leaders, you know? Most of the time, I think the previous two objectives, like short-range objectives and capitalizing on middle-range objectives, is very, very important. Even Bini, before asking that question, really, what will be our I think what the debate on our short range objective, of course, no one really may not really question the territorial integrity of Ethiopia, definitely. May some others may want to do that, but as a nation,
boldly speaking and frankly speaking, we have been experiencing a sense of governance that has been giving territorial territorial integrity without the consensus of the people of Ethiopia, and they have been honest for the people and for the policies that they have been following for Ethiopia. So it's I don't believe in that, doctor. Territorial consensus even have not been solid and uncompromising policy for Ethiopia, in the case of Ethiopia, because in the past 27 years, the border which is located around Namara region, Metamma area, has been cut out and given for Sudan, and Ethiopia has been living without የባህርበር ሳይኖራት ነው እስካሁን ድረስ የቆየችው because of ማለት ነው ይሄ territorial consensus ላይ ምንም የመስማማት ይሄ ገቨርመንቶች especially for the past 29 years ማለት ይቻላል ያልተ ኢትዮጵያ ውስጥ በዚህ ይስማማሉ short term long term ብለን ልንለው ምን ይችላል አይመስለኝም it's that's my personal opinion.
Yeah, I agree with you, by the way. I agree with you. That's really, you make it Ethiopia, you ask the question from Ethiopian perspective, and that's the reality, by the way. But this is a national, it is an international experience, so the international model. So we have to at least, we have to see that in the international model, in the international tradition, one of the best experience is that at least governments never compromise with their short range, mid range, normally these objectives. In terms of long range objectives, they may really correct, okay? They may really correct and like that. I can mention the example of Alaska. Alaska is one of the biggest areas that was purchased in almost a cheated manner from Russia to America, you know? Because the Americans were very wise and they saw it from long-range perspective. But no one was in a debate that Alaska should be part of America. But the Russians say that, no, they were really worrying that time, not for the long-range objectives, rather for unifying themselves just for the short-range objectives. So it's not only just losing one's own territory. So what I'm saying is, the danger is at least from two sides. The first danger is, even in the absence of this mutual understanding over long range or middle range or short range objective, in the absence of consensus on these issues domestically, nations may enter into international agreements. That's very dangerous, you know. That's why, for example, Ethiopia has lost some of its ports. It's not a... It was a short-range decision. It was seen from short-range objective, like establishing peace and then like that. But its repercussion, its effect, even isn't compromising its long-range objective. So we have to really work much on this one. And the role of think tank groups, and then the role of just what you call it, our experience. And I said it, for example, the first step in formulating the foreign policy, the assessment stage. Really, we have to do well on that one. Before really coming up whatever type of document, we have to give much attention to the assessment. Where are we? Where are we really? Where, how, what have been we before, you know? How was our history looks like? Now, where are we now? And where are we heading? So if we are not agreeing on this one, for Ethiopian context, it's very difficult to deal with this one. So I really urge all the important actors and all the think tank groups, all the stakeholders really first to really define and to have a consensus on the assessment, I mean, on the Aziz.
Agaroche yallabacho da, doctor. Agaroche yeminorabacho, international debt malatno. Long range objective achon lay compromise in the Araguader Gum, Lemsale, the Kenyan case might chalal, Ugandan case might chalal, Yerasham case on, hey, Alaska, but debt amakang in the Benebarabacho da. አማካኝነት ይመስለኛል የተወሰደውና ላይክ ኢትዮጵያን ኢትዮጵያ አሁን ያላትን ኢትዮጵያን ኤርላይንስ የባር ትራንዚትን ሎጂስቲክን አሰ ሶቪኒር ጋራንቲ ኮምፕሮማይዝ የማይደረጉ ነገሮችን ኮምፕሮማይዝ አድርገው ያሳዙበት ሁኔታ አለ እና እንዴት ነው ከእዳ ጋር ተያይዞ ሎንግ ሬንጅ ኦብጀክቲቭዎችን ሴት ማድረግና ለማድረግ የሚቻልበት ሁኔታ
That's difficult, by the way. We should not think of that. If we really are not dealing, of course, we have to define what will be our long-range objective. ምን መሆን ነው የምንፈልገው? የሚለውን ነገር ለመመለስ really where are we now የሚለው ሴት ማድረግ ያስፈልጋል። ለምሳሌ ቴሌ for example 40% of ቴሌ will be privatized soon. Yeah? Ethio Telecom. Really ምን ታይቶ ነው የሚለው ነገር የራሱ የሆነ pluses and minuses ይኖርታል. At least በነዚህ ፕላስ ኤን ማይነስ ላይ ኮንሰንሰስ ማምጣት በጣም ኤቭሪባዲ አግሪ ላይ ያደርግ ይችላል አትሊስት ኤቭሪባዲ አይ ሚን ኤቭሪቲንግ ሜይ ኖት ሃቭ ላይክ ኦል ፕላስስ ኤቭሪቲንግ ሜይ ኖት ሃቭ ኦል ማይነስስ ሶ አትሊስት ግን በፕላስስ ኤን በማይነሶቹ ላይ በአድቫንቴጅስ ኤን ዲስአድቫንቴጅስ ኦፍ ዳት ዳይሬክሽን ላይ ኮንሰንሰስ መመኖር አለበት ምክንያቱም ኢፍ ዴር ኢዝ አ ኮንሰንሰስ ዴፊኒትሊ ዌን ዴር አር ሰም ፋቨራብል ኮንዲሽንስ ካም that policy direction may be really modified. So I really, any other Nantono Malasohiti, I really know, you need to deal with that. This is the one that the whole media, really, for example, eating your media, and also Ethiopia foreign policy in Dao. Bakanus can meet our levels, national medias, Bakanus Tamigor, really, how much weight is really provided like a football in Dao? Yeah, look, when you Ethiopia foreign policy, yeah, girl, you foreign policy. Like that. And now, katachara binorachu like foreign policy television site. You know what I'm saying? But I'm attention is set to igabar malatno. Hey, sibbal ahoni allom macho bicha. We met our forecast bicha seyo. Skazari enabbaru. The experience of countries on this one. But I'm buzun agar review tadargo. So watch wadand mamdat mchala lapa. Hey, demu malat. So watch wadand mamdat. Everybody wadand limata laita bagi chila. Key actors, for example. Key actors on this issue, right? Agri Marago Kona, states or regions at least, Agri Marago Kona, Zalay, define Maragichar. Leave alone Bini Indo, Yagaritoan, Territory Karto, Ursubers Agarustunqua, Wasaneka Zinom, Eok, almost to go, we are at the verge of war, is that not even my border is this Kaziwale Antano, Kaziwae, Batamka Barnona, E Batamone Lepetum. If we are really talking about foreign policy, መጀመሪያ በዶሜስቲክ ማተሮች ላይ በጣም መስራት ያስፈልጋል በዶሜስቲክ ማተሮች ላይ ዓለም ስራታችን ደግሞ እንደ ሀገር ኦር እንደ ና ካንትሪ አት ፎሪን ፖሊሲ ወይ በዓለም አቀፍ እንትን ላይ ሉዘር ይሆን እንደሆነ የዚህ ሎስ ኮስቱ ደግሞ ቀስ ብሎ በጀነሬሽን ላይ እንደሚመጣ መርሳት የለብንም ዴርፎር ኢንተርናሽናል ሎስ ኢን ተርምስ ኦፍ ፎሪን ፖሊሲ ኢዝ አ ፋንክሽን ኦፍ ሎስ ኢን ዶሜስቲክ ፖሊሲ ኢኔ በዛ ነው ማለት በዶሜስቲክ ፖሊሲዎቻችን ውስጥ ያለ ሎስ ለሀገር ያለን ለኢንተግሪቲ ያለን ለባንዲራ ያለን ለህዝብ ያለን ሀገር ለሚለው ዴፊኒሽን ላይ ያለን አመለካከትና ዶክመንቴሽን ዳፊኒትሊ የራሱ የሆነ ሪፐርከሽን አለው በፎሪን ፖሊሲ ሜኪንግ ላይ ኦኬ ስለዚህ እዛ ላይ ዲል ማድረግ ነው ኢተራቲቭ ፕሮሰስ አለው ዶሜስቲክ ፖሊሲውን ስናይ ዳፊኒትሊ ፎሪን ፖሊሲውንም እናይበት ዘይኖራል ፎሪን ፖሊሲውን አይተንም ዶሜስቲክ ፖሊሲያችንንም ክራፍት ልናደርግ ይችላል ኢት ኢዝ ሪሊ a very good case in point banagarachin la ethiopia bichatiyut if you go to belgium almost 11 million population we have they have the same fate for example what should be our policy with let's say benelux I mean they have the benelux means the belgium netherlands and luxembourg nei sosto agaroch andande benelux ibaralna ka europa abratum tinish part of bionum like a benelux or regional blocks የሚሰሩበት ሁኔታ አለ like the North Sea for example how can we really work with great UK they have a North Sea in between Belgium and UK እንዴት አድርገን ነው የሚለው በአንደርግራውንድ ላይ ያላቸው ትብብር ራሱ በጣም የሚገርም ነው even if with all these ጩኸቶች ማለት ነው like the Brexit or like that እና ምን ለማፈልጊ ነው even to answer that we have to revisit our domestic policies domestic policies-ዎቻችንን revisit ማድረግ ደግሞ አመታት ፈጅተን ነገሮች ሁሉ ተቀየሩ በኋላ ወደ ዘመን parallelly እያየን እያመጋገበን መሄድ ያለብን ነው ይታለና I think who is doing the Ethiopian policy analysis? Yemanno assignment?
That's my assignment.
Wow. We expect super lecture on that. And definitely you will come up with a number of researchable as well as questions that may go for the media for debate, you know. Thank you very much. Of course, I think 25% of the lecture time is for the class. So I hope by next week I will finalize the lecture and the remaining will be your lecture. Yandandachu bias andandikan satachu chilalo or half a day. So get ready on that one. Thank you really for your interesting question, Vini. Altamallasa magallaw you will answer it.
Okay.
The other thing is okay ngidi foreign policy action it will be like that or this like this nil inchilalen but we have to really understand what are the determinants kidim yeteyekachu tiyake alle like power ndet no mi determine mi hono no of course indirectly we are talking about determinants of really foreign policy because foreign policy depends on power ka indirectly these factors are the determinants factors example facts for the foreign policy marathon. So there is a flux, I mean, state of flux. And these factors, state of flux means always they are in interaction and their dynamic. For example, population with technology, population with economy, territory with population, territory with international political relation, territory with military, you know, there is what you call it a flux of dynamics. So the determinants can be classified one into external determinants of foreign policy and the second one is the internal determinants for foreign policy pardon this is really internal you know I'm sorry for that internal determinants and external determinants When you say external determinants, normally it means, I hope something is external. Sorry. External determinants. It refers to those factors that influence and determine the foreign policy of a country. Some of these factors are static or unchanging in nature, whereas others are really immunological, I'm sorry. The first one is the external determinants. External determinants, I make it somehow really ugly, almost PowerPoint in this case. I thought you can really do that and like that one. So it says one is the power structure. How the power structure, alam la yallo power structure, but am tilik foundation allo yim takamuto al tawlo mitasabbet. Ka 1648 the treaty of westphalia ibalal or the tw ibalal kaza eski betechale metal lamam bemokru during that time the modern state system include like the major the middling and small powers bro agaru rasachu yaskamukbet huneta alle kaza bwala alamun le colonization yamachachubet huneta na yallo gen kaza bwala betam buzu itekayiru negoroch yallo like the world wars the multipolar system the bipolar system the north west the south east the socialist communist whatever like that okay all these blocks betam esrazu ye the global power structure is a big book liodaw michitil entenno betam ትልቅ ፖይንት ኦፍ ዲቤት ወይም ደግሞ በጣም ኢንትረስቲንግ ትረካ ሊደረግበት ወይም አናሊሲስ የሚሰራበት ነው። Especially the creation of different blocks and the creation of the establishment of a number of economic, like the Bretton Woods institutions, like IMF and World Bank, even the League of Nations, even after the First World War, and then the other organizations like blocks, like NATO, like the Global War on Terrorism, like GOAT. Yeah, I don't know. But like the time of biological weapons right now, and then, you know, what's really happening in our world. So anyway, we're talking about really the power. The first important external determinant factor for policy is the power structure. How is the power structure of our world looks like, and where we are in that power structure? I don't know. The other thing is the international organizations. So determinants are like international organizations. Our world is full of a number of international organizations, and we have to ask our position in those international organizations. For example, we want to maximize our economic benefit or our economic advantage from international trade, but our place in terms of world trade organization is not like that much. So where is our place in the various influential international organizations? They can be part of the international external determinants. Even among the external determinants, consider reaction of others. What will be the reaction of others? Just considering the reaction of others blocks. Who are these others? Are they really powerful, or where are they in that power structure? Even the world public opinion, how will be the opinion of the global consumer or the global community? These are some of the external determinants. Even alliance, what type of alliance do you have? Which alliance will be positive to our policy that we are standing for, and which are not? So what are the different areas? You can imagine, for example, you can remember the Arab League, how they are really reacting to the Ethiopian domestic policy of fulfilling its energy demand and removing or minimizing citizen darkness across Ethiopia by building up by dam or the Nile dam. So the great reason. So alliances. Alliance means what alliance do we have? What alliance are in between us, and what alliance are really positive to us and not to our policy and not. So this is what we call it, the five important external determinants for foreign policy. Definitely, the calculation of global power, the calculation of that country in global power will be also considered. Like, for example, international organization. What Trump was saying, if you remember, almost we are contributing 7 or 8 times the budget of what China or country X really contributed to World Health Organization. So they are really magnifying their place. We are contributing that. So in terms of marking their place, the place of USA compared to the place of China in international organizations, they may not have the same score. By the way, there are a number of proxy questionnaires and indicators for this one. The other one is internal determinants, like the historical influence that country has, and the historical influence that nation has in the geopolitical setup that community is really arriving, the size and geography of that country. Geography, I mean, just you can see the size and the location. When you say the location, it includes, it's not only geography. We can have the human geography and the physical geography that the country is really dealing with. And then the natural resource base of the country, the economic development trends and the level of economic development of that country, the industrial development, how much industrialization, and the military power, the level of the military power that the nation has, and the number as well as the quality of population that the country is endowed with, and then the level of good governance and the leadership quality that the nation is dealing with, even the political organization, history, and then the goodwill or the badwill associated to the strength of those political organizations in that country. And the last one is the quality of diplomacy. How much is the quality? Quality of diplomacy, please read in this one. How do you measure the quality of diplomacy? You know, under each one, there are a number of parameters. Remember, it's a two-credit hour course, so I don't want to just indulge in detail on all these matters, but at least I have to show you these are some of the important determinants for foreign policy making, the variables that we can really develop in our foreign policy. And this is all about for today. I think it will be enough. If you have any question, comment or suggestion, you are most welcome, or you can substantiate some of my talks on this. Definitely next week, at least half, like 20 or 15 minutes in analysis biggest chapter, and then we'll start the fourth chapter on the first day of, we'll start and finish the fourth chapter by Thursday. The fifth and the sixth chapter will be finalized by next week. If you have questions, you are most welcome. If not, just rest and relax. Question, comment? I will send you the number last time, again. አንዳንድ ነገሮችን ትንሽ ኢንሪች ላደርገው ብዬ ያው ከካሪኩለም ጋር እንዳለ መሄድ ባያስፈልግም ግን ትንሽ እናንተን በሚጠቅምና ጊዜያችሁን በማያስጠፋ መልኩ ትንሽ ሰማራይዝ ማድረግ ስላለብኝ ነው። ዴፊኒትሊ ባይ ቱሞሮ አይ ዊል ሴንድ ዩ ዩዚንግ ዘ ዊ ትራንስፈር አይ ኖ ሃው ማች ቢዚ ዩ አር ሶ አይ ሃቭ ቱ ኮንሲደር ዩ ኦል ዲስ ኤንድ ዴን ዘ ኔክስት ሌክቸርስ ዊል ቢ ሳምሃው ማክሲመም 20 slides to the point, and then we can wind up the course. Okay. If you have any comment or suggestion, please, if you have any inconvenience, let me know. Who is driving?
I think Hi Luis, the one is driving.
Okay, good. So he's almost to go. So see you then on Thursday, my colleagues.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you very much.
ለዩነት መፍጠር አላማችን ነው። ዓለም አቀፍ ተወዳዳሪ መሆን አለባችሁ። የናሽናል ኤርዌይስ እህት ኩባንያ ናሽናል አቪዬሽን ኮሌጅ ጥራትና ደረጃውን የተጠበቀ ስልጠና በመስጠት ብቁ ዜጋ ያፈራን ነው። በፍላይት ኦፕሬሽን፣ በበረራ መስተንግዶ፣ በቲኬቲንግና ሪዘርቬሽን፣ በሆቴልና ቱሪዝም ሙያዎች አሰልጥነን ተወዳዳሪ እናደርጋለን። ኮሌጃችን ካናዳ ከሚገኘው ኢንተርናሽናል ኤር ትራንስፖርት አሶሲኤሽን አያታና ከእንግሊዙ ICM ጋር በመተባበር ዓለም አቀፍ ዕውቅና ያለው ስልጠና እየሰጠ ይገኛል። በፍላይት ኦፕሬሽን በበረራ መስተንግዶ የምንሰጣቸው ስልጠና ከኢትዮጵያ ሲቪል አቪዬሽን ባለስልጣን ሙሉ ዕውቅና አለው። አድራሻ ከጎላጉል ታወር 22 አደባባይ ወደ ሾላ በሚወስደው መንገድ ላይ የናሽናል ኤርዌይስ እህት ኩባንያ ናሽናል አቪዬሽን ኮሌጅ ህልሞን እውን ያድርጋል።